Hello, we are the SpaceX fans and welcome to the SpaceX Show, the place where you can stay up to date with everything SpaceX. We have a huge video today and a variety of standard SpaceX news to start today's video. The first bit of information is something I forgot to report on in my Wednesday video. After multiple delays during the week, SpaceX tweeted about the separation of the CRS-22 Dragon from the ISS on Thursday. Then, later in the day on Thursday, SpaceX tweeted splashdown of Dragon confirmed, completing SpaceX's 22nd cargo resupply mission to the space station. I want to share this super cool video posted by Elon Musk on Twitter of SpaceX's next drone ship called a shortfall of Gravitors. It has been filmed out at sea, likely doing sea trials, so it shouldn't be much longer before this new drone ship is operational for Falcon recoveries. In response to that ASOG video tweet, Michael Baylor asked a question about the drone ship. He said, "Will ASOG be fully automated? No tugboat required." Musk responded with, "Yes." Jeff Faust posted a tweet with a picture saying, "Useful chart from NASA's Launch Services Program presented at today's Planetary Sciences Decadal Survey Steering Committee meeting comparing performance of launch vehicles at several C3 characteristic energy values." Musk responded and said, "Accurate, show that Falcon Heavy addresses all use cases." Scott Manley tweeted about Jeff Faust's tweet saying, "Putting the C3 numbers into plain English." Musk responded with, "We could stretch the Falcon Heavy upper stage and increase this a lot, but Falcon Heavy already covers all known payloads. Starship, especially with orbital refilling and dedicated deep space variants, no heat shield flaps or header tanks will take this up orders of magnitude." A former NASA astronaut and SpaceX engineer posted a tweet. He said, "When I started at SpaceX, Elon Musk was insistent that everything looked cool, but as an engineer, I didn't care how they looked as long as they worked. What I didn't grasp at the time was that Elon wanted to get the whole world excited about flying in space." Musk responded and said, "Absolutely. Thought I would share an article posted recently." It says, "Federal regulators said Thursday they can now better track rocket launches and space vehicles returning to Earth, which could cut the amount of time that airplanes must be routed around space operations." NASA also recently posted an article. It says, "NASA and Northrop Grumman of Dulles, Virginia have finalized a contract to develop the Habitation and Logistics Outpost for Gateway, which will be a critical way station and outpost in orbit around the moon as part of NASA's Artemis program. This Halo component will launch sometime around November of 2024 on a Falcon Heavy rocket." Moving on to the Boca Chica action, the orbital launch site tank farm has been slowly progressing. The hydraulic rams have been installed into the suborbital pad B launch mount. The boom for the integration tower stacking crane is being prepared for extension. Here's a view of the 8th and final vehicle integration tower segment. The cryotank shells at the propellant production site are progressing. Here's a view of the new mystery structure being constructed. Two large cylinders were spotted delivered to the production yard. Elon Musk posted a couple of tweets to do with a new facility to support Raptor production. The first says, "We are breaking ground soon on a second Raptor factory at SpaceX Texas test site. This will focus on volume production of Raptor 2 while California factory will make Raptor vacuum and new experimental designs." Then he also posted, "By volume production I mean 2 to 4 engines per day. That's super high volume for big rocket engines but low volume by automotive standards." In response to the breaking ground tweet, Musk was asked at Starbase or McGregor. He responded with McGregor. Musk was also asked, "What volume production are you aiming for? Quantity of Raptors per year?" He responded with roughly 800 to 1,000 per year. "That's about what's needed over 10 years to create the fleet to build a self-sustaining city on Mars. City itself probably takes roughly 20 years, so hopefully it is built by approximately 2050. Musk was asked yet another question of, "Is the plan still to have an engine factory at Starbase or has that changed now that there will be one in McGregor?" He responded and said the challenges of operating at Starbase left us with no choice but to put engine production in McGregor. Eric Berger posted asking, so Texas is going to have an orbital launch site and a major rocket engine factory in addition to the Starship build site. This was hard to imagine even a few years ago. Musk said yes, it will be the highest output and most advanced rocket engine factory in the world. There was a tweet posted which says, it's surreal to think that within a few years space travel going to Moon and Mars will become as common as traveling by flight. SpaceX engineers are working hard towards achieving that. Starship is the key to making life multiplanetary. Musk responded with, absolutely, staggeringly insane amount of work between now and then. Chris G asked a question to Elon Musk on Starship with, have you looked at a variant of Starship that is essentially the probe too? Instead of paying to build two things, could a deep space Starship incorporate those science instruments? Reduce cost even a little more for science missions? Musk responded and said, yeah, that would be cool. Also, using ship itself as structure for new giant telescope that's more than 10 times Hubble resolution. Was talking to Saul Perlmutter, who's awesome, and he suggested wanting to do that. Then Musk was asked, has SpaceX ever considered tethering two crew starships to create artificial gravity en route to Mars? Elon Musk responded with yes. I wanted to share a tweet from Everyday Astronaut on Starship. He said, another reminder, Starship is a system, it's not a single vehicle. There will be variants of Starship that absolutely do not fit the normal mold, including tanker versions, lunar, and even potentially deep space versions. So, expect some with and without legs, flaps, nose cone, etc. Musk then responded with true. Musk posted a super cool picture of Raptors in Boca Chica on Twitter, captioned Fellowship of the Raptors. This Raptor Boost 5 engine was spotted delivered to Boca Chica. In the background here you can see the midbay with GSC-3 and part of Ship 20 inside. The ground support equipment tank GSC-3 has since been moved out of the midbay. At some point during the week, Super Heavy Booster 3 was seen venting. Michael Baylor posted a couple of tweets on Thursday in regards to the first Super Heavy Booster 3 test. The first says, the road is closed and SpaceX teams have cleared the pad for Booster 3 testing this evening. Window lasts until midnight. Likely an ambient proof first, but the NASA spaceflight team will go live if they get to cryo. There is another window from 6 a.m. to 8 p.m. on Friday as well. Then he also tweeted, and the road is open. Just a brief ambient proof this evening. Cryogenic proof testing is possible in the long window on Friday. After the ambient pressure test, crews were seen working on B3 for further testing, possibly a cryo proof up next. There was a tweet posted with a picture of La Padre Stream saying Raptor serial number 57 was installed onto Booster 3 last night. I'll also share the road and beach closures on the Cameron County website. There are a load of dates that have been added for this coming week, starting with a closure tomorrow, Monday 12th, likely for Booster 3 testing. Then, in addition, there is a closure scheduled for Tuesday, Wednesday and Thursday next week. Finally, for this Sunday video, as always, we have the latest Starbase production diagram thanks to Brendan Lewis. He's included more construction in this version of the diagram and we can see stuff is progressing very nicely, particularly with orbital infrastructure. Of course, it goes without saying, but these detailed Starship updates wouldn't be possible without Mary out filming in Boca Chica constantly, so thanks to her. Also, thanks to the NASA spaceflight team working hard behind the scenes to put together their great videos, live streams, and other space content. It's been a while since I mentioned it, but for those unaware, we have a store where you can get some cool SpaceX themed stickers. There's a link in the description to that. Also, if you want to join a bunch of space fans, we have a Discord server, so feel free to come and join us. There's a link to that in the description too. That's it for this episode of The SpaceX Show. I hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, make sure to hit the like button and leave a comment down below. If you want to stay updated with SpaceX info, make sure to subscribe and press the bell icon to get notified when I upload. Thanks for watching and have a great day.